Welcome to the Buchanan Report, this 30th day of April, 2019. My name is Ivan Buchanan, and I am your host. And my co-host, as always, Ron Hanks and Rhonda Moon Lane. If you're joining us for the first time, our call-in number is 347-857-1710. Again, that number, 347-857-1710. And for those of you that do call in, please watch your language. Try to keep it as clean as we can. Our guest tonight is Commander John Wells with updates on the fight for Blue Water Navy vets regarding Agent Orange benefits. But before we get to our guest tonight, we want to remind everyone that our website is thebuchananreport.com, thebuchananreport.com, where tons of news and links just from one end of the spectrum to the next. Go there, check it out, thebuchananreport.com. Okay, outside of that, I'm ready to go right to you, Rhonda, except just want to make a note of it. For those of you, I don't really see the main news covering it, but down there in Venezuela, there's a lot of shooting going on back and forth, so I want to take a look at that. It's heating up pretty good. All right, Rhonda, over to you.
Well, I know we've covered this before, medical marijuana. There's a story came out. A 36-year-old retired major went to West Point just before September 2011, served active duty for 11 years, two combat tours, one in Iraq and one in Afghanistan. He got out, he retired, and he went to work as the director of operations for Acreage Holdings, which is a cannabis venture. Now the Judge Advocate General's office at West Point said that this brings discredit upon the U.S. Military Academy and a military officer working in the... Yeah. So they have pretty much made it impossible for his 11 years, when he finishes his 20, to retire, because they're taking away his 11 years.
The guy's got a legal job.
Uh-huh.
That's just not right. Yeah.
It's a publicly traded company. Now, it is in Canada. It isn't a U.S. company because it can't be traded here. Cannabis is legal in 33 states for recreational and, or 10 for recreational and 33 for medical. But as we've discussed, it's not legalized at federal level.
Yeah, that, and I just read something today, too, that apparently Congress is looking at passing or did pass something, at, you know, not law yet, got to go to the Senate, but, you know, about getting marijuana off the books as far as, you know, being a crime to use, so, you know, from a federal standpoint. Yep.
Well, so, you know, we've said it before. They say that you can talk to your doctor about using medical marijuana if you live in one of the states that it's legal. But also,
yeah, but isn't there a problem
federally,
if you live in a state that's legal, that if you use it, you could lose your VA benefits or a portion thereof? Yeah.
If it's a, if they charge you federally, yes, because it's still not legal federally.
Since the VA is federally funded, you know, if you follow this whole thought process of how it all fits together.
Yeah. So, I don't know. Maybe eventually they'll make it legal. I know they will not prescribe any opiates if you use medical marijuana. So they have little rules like that.
Well, that's a good rule.
Yeah. There's one or two. It's not, the VA doesn't, it's not one of the things they come across the board and say you can't. It's up to the doctor. So there are a couple doctors at the VAs that will do it. But we also know there's a few doctors at VAs that don't have medical licenses, so.
Yeah.
maybe those are the ones that will prescribe it. And then another one today, a pharmacist at the VA was indicted for alleged drug theft schemes, stealing prescription drugs of Shreveport, L.A. Who is it? We have a whistleblower there. It is Jermaine.
Shreveport, Louisiana?
Yeah, that's Shay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Shay. Yeah.
20 counts of fraud for stealing controlled substances from the veterans who were supposed to be receiving the drugs. She worked at the pharmacy. I guess she doesn't work there anymore, so hopefully they did fire her. She stole various quantities of hydrocodone, codeine, diazepam, and morphine. The maximum sentence, and I thought this was kind of light, 4 years imprisonment, 3 years of supervised release, and $250,000 fine for each count if convicted.
No reason not to steal the drugs.
Yeah, well, I guess 20 counts of stealing, so she could get 4 years for each count. So I would doubt they would ever do that, but in 2017, VA Secretary David Shulton said 300 out of the 1,500 then pending cases against employees involved drug theft.
Yeah.
They have zero tolerance, and it's cause for immediate removal. About 3% of the reported case of drug loss or theft include doctors, nurses, or employees ended in discipline, not charges. And that's all I have tonight.
Good.
Lots of great news.
Well,
that was wonderful.
Along those same lines, though, Rhonda, the Grand Junction Daily Sentinel, their health section last week, printed up an article on a survey by the National Academies, a report they put out dealing with medical marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
And chronic pain is the most common reason people give for enrolling for the medical program. And that's followed by stiffness from multiple sclerosis or chemotherapy-related nausea. Came about 85% of the patients' reasons were supported by substantial or conclusive evidence. I mean, there's a whole bunch of places where they're doing this that they don't have the evidence. They're not waiting for the 7 or 8 years that they want to do all these major studies and whatnot that way, which is I'm kind of thankful for, because you stop and look at it, it's been studied for so long, they should already have a lot of those answers.
I agree.
They just don't want to look at it.
Yeah.
Yeah. On another note, the U.S. Postal Service has let loose plans for a new forever stamp. And it's honoring the U.S. military working dogs, four different breeds. The German Shepherd, the Labrador Retriever, the Belgian Malinois, and the Dutch Shepherd. And I was going, a Dutch Shepherd, and I got to looking at the pictures. Well, the German Shepherd, they have the low slung back hips.
Yes.
And the Dutch Shepherd is a lot more upright with a stance. So
I guess I dated the German Shepherd.
Yeah, well. Were you at the bar or what?
A couple times. I'm sure there's plenty of servicemen out there that have stories about that as well. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. A lot of different references that I'm going to stay away from.
Yeah, please don't.
Yeah. Yeah. Another article that came out concerning service dogs in the Grand Junction Sentinel was they had a picture on the front page of this gal with a dog, and she's kneeling in front of it just in tears. Well, this was a 2-year-old pit bull. Pit mix, I believe, yeah.
Uh-huh.
That had been rescued by a project in Grand Junction. And he was being flown by a volunteer flight outfit that flies animals to North Carolina to meet up with a Marine Corps veteran that has equilibrium issues to help him. Helps him with his balance. I guess he mm-hmm. lived out here in Grand Junction and hooked up with the dog and then had to move back there. And they got the money together and the help to fly him back there. As soon as he gets there, he starts his training.
Good.
And I think this dog is one of the first ever pit bull service dogs. You know, everybody's, not a pit. Anybody that's been around a pit that was properly raised, no, they're one of the biggest babies there is. All they want to do is...
I can testify firsthand. I know many people that have pit bulls and properly trained, et cetera. They're just wonderful, wonderful animals.
Yes.
I'll
tell you that.
This guy's already got one service dog. He's got a Chihuahua that helps him with PTSD.
Right.
Yeah, PTSD and diabetes, you know. So there's going to be a pair to draw to you right there when he goes walking
uh-huh.
in the place. And I'll bet you that Chihuahua.
I'll bet you
right.
the Chihuahua bullies the pit bull.
Yeah, and probably looks at the public and goes, what are you going to do about it?
Yeah. Chihuahua's in command, no doubt.
Yep. Well, that's all I have for tonight.
All right. Then we're going to take a short break. When we come back, we will be speaking with Commander John Wells with updates on the fight for Blue Water Navy vets regarding Agent Orange benefits. This is the Buchanan Report. We'll be back here in just one moment.
Hey, da dee ding dong, a lang a lang a lang, boom ba do, ba do ba do ba bay.
Oh, life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love, life could be a dream, sweetheart.
Hello, hello again, shaboom, and hoping we'll meet again.
Oh, life could be a dream. If only all my precious plans would come true. If you would let me spend my whole life loving you, life could be a dream, sweetheart. Now every time I look at you, something is on my mind. If you do what I want you to,
baby, we'd be so fine.
Oh, life could be a dream if I could take you up in paradise up above. If you would tell me I'm the only one that you love, life could be a dream, sweetheart.
Shaboom, shaboom, ya-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la, shaboom, shaboom, ya-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la, shaboom, shaboom, ya-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la, shaboom. Shaboom, shaboom.
Thank you for listening to the Buchanan Report radio show. Our guest tonight is retired U.S. Navy Commander John Wells. He is also the Executive Director of the Louisiana-based Nonpartisan Military Veterans Advocacy. Hi, Commander. How are you tonight?
Rhonda, I'm doing just wonderful. How about yourself?
I am doing okay. I had dental work yesterday, so a little bit sore, but we're good. Yeah, they started my implants. So.
Oh, wow. Well, you know, at least once you get it over with, you'll have a nice smile and everything else. So that's great.
Exactly. It is.
But you still have to go through it, and that's never fun.
Never, but it's okay. I can deal with it. So what's going on with the Blue Water Navy vets?
Well, since the last time we talked, a lot has happened. As you probably have heard, Congress failed to pass the Blue Water Navy bill at the end of last Congress. Now, what had happened was the VA had gone into the Congressional Budget Office and dumped a whole bunch of bogus figures. Okay, once those things were dumped, the CBO rescored the bill and actually estimated a cost greater than what our offset was. Now, we met with the CBO in January, and we provided them with better figures. They looked at ours and actually said, you know, look, we kind of agree with you guys. We think the VA was pretty bogus. And so we got the cost of it back down. At the same time, we'd also taken a case into the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit by the name of Procopio versus Wilkie. And remember, military veterans advocacy, we don't just advocate, we also litigate. And in this particular case, we asked the Court of Appeals for the Federal Circuit to find that the Territorial Sea was part of the Republic of Vietnam, and for purposes of the Agent Orange Act of 91, that they would go ahead and say that anybody who was in the Territorial Sea receives a presumption of exposure. The court gave us everything we asked for in a 9-2 decision by the entire Court of Appeals. They came up and said, look, you know, international law is what it is. We've signed a couple of treaties, and I think you've heard me talk about them before. And, you know, under those treaties, Vietnam can claim sovereignty over the Territorial Sea. And since Congress had used the formal name of the of South Vietnam, the Republic of Vietnam, well, golly, you know, that Republic of Vietnam included the Territorial Sea. Now, and that was wonderful because now all of a sudden we've encompassed about 80,000 or so Navy veterans that have been cut off. All the people in the harbors like Da Nang or Bung Tao or Nha Trang are now covered and really out throughout the Territorial Sea. To make it more interesting, Vietnam uses what they call a straight baseline method to compute their Territorial Sea, which is legal under the conventions and under the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. What that means is they draw a line between the outermost islands on the fringe islands, I guess you would call them, outside the coastline or off the coastline, and that marks the start of the Territorial Sea. So in some points, the Territorial Sea for South Vietnam was out to about 80 nautical miles. So all this was great and wonderful, and then the court did one other thing. As they said, gee, there's also a VA regulation that calls for the presumption to be included in waters offshore. And they asked us at oral argument, well, what is waters offshore? And, you know, we had to kind of respond and say we really didn't know because it's not been defined, but it's further out than the Territorial Sea. Okay. So they asked the VA attorneys, and they said basically the same thing. Hey, we don't know, but it's past the Territorial Sea. And in the decision itself, the court found that, in fact, waters offshore went past the Territorial Sea. Judge Lori's concurrence basically said, look, we don't even have to worry about the statute or the Territorial Sea. Anybody in waters offshore is eligible for the presumption of exposure. So this was really a great thing. It not only opened up for 80,000, 80, 90,000 deaths in the Territorial Sea, but, you know, as many as 25 or 30,000 further on. And, you know, and this is not a case of us just trying to fake something up. You know, we have hydrologist reports that show that the dioxin and the debris and everything else coming out of the rivers will go out, you know, as far as 160 miles off the coast. In New Jersey, when Diamond Shoals plant had a spill into the Passaic River, it went out 150 nautical miles from shore. Okay, so, you know, going out that far was not anything unusual, and in fact, those ships out there were exposed. So with the Procopio decision, we were all pretty well riding high. I met with Secretary Wilkie a couple of times, and the first one was just a couple of days after the Procopio decision came down, and he basically said, okay, guys, we're going to take a look at this and see what we're going to do. Subsequent meetings, he said, all right, You guys took us to court. You won. Fine. We're going to implement it. And I met with him about 2.5 weeks ago, and he's moving forward with that implementation. All of the stays that were in effect in the Court of Appeals of the Veterans Claims have been lifted. All the stays that are in effect in the Board of Veterans Appeals have been lifted. And we are working, and some people are starting to get their benefits now. We're working with them on a rulemaking request to try to actually extend the presumption not only to the territorial sea, but into the waters offshore as well. Okay. So everything is going fine. And, of course, you know, as you can imagine, just because it's going fine doesn't mean it's going to keep on going fine.
Right.
So we got some news from Congress. Now, I would ask you to remember the VSOs didn't get coverage for these Navy veterans. Okay. The Legion didn't. The VFW didn't. The DAV didn't. In fact, in many cases, the VFW actually interfered with us. Congress didn't get coverage for these Navy veterans. They had their chance.
Right.
We played with it for about 10 years, and they could never get it. They could never get it through. So now, Congress is coming in, and the VSOs are coming in, and they're defining the waters offshore as the same geographic coordinates as the territorial sea. So there's a legislative hearing tomorrow in D.C. at the House Veterans Affairs Committee, and they're going to try to justify that the bill containing these geographic coordinates is what they should adopt. Now, the problem is, Rondi, if they pass this bill, then the courts are going to look at it and say, water's offshore, that's the territorial sea. Okay, Congress has spoken. That's the end of it. And we're going to cut out a bunch of folks that were very close to the territorial sea but did not quite get into it. And there's a lot of carriers up around the Gulf of Tonkin and on Yankee Station that were outside the territorial sea when they transited south to go on to Liberty Port or the Philippines or whatever, okay? They would come close. Sometimes they would actually nick it. Sometimes they would be just outside of it. These carriers are going to be left behind if this bill passes in the language that it's got. So we've got a situation that Congress has screwed this up for the last decade, okay, and now they're coming in and want to do it their way, and they'll probably, and theoretically they could pass the bill and actually cut off a whole bunch of sailors, as many as 25 to 30,000 sailors that we have gotten the benefits from the court. I raised hell about it. They're not letting me testify tomorrow. Gee, I wonder why. You know, I'm up here in D.C. ready to go, and they said, no, you can't testify. We're just going to talk to the VFW and everybody else that agrees with us. So it's
why?
Because they want to pass.
I know
a bill.
Why. Yeah, I know.
Here's the thing. When Procopio passed, okay, all of a sudden there's not any problem with the PAYSGO Act. There's no offset requirement because now the VA has to take it out of Hyde. Okay, they want to go ahead and pass the bill because they know they can pass it. There's not going to be a cost offset, and they want to keep the big VSOs like the VFW happy because they're afraid that the VFW will not invite him to speak at their convention or something to that effect. The problem is these folks are playing politics, and they're playing politics with the lives of my people, and I'm not real happy about it. So we're in the situation where theoretically, in fact, potentially, we can snatch defeat from the jaws of victory. And it's just really kind of ticking me off. I've got the Mike Yates, who's the commander of the Blue Water Navy Vietnam Veterans Association, the national commander, and he was up here with me. We've gone around. We've talked to all these folks. We tried to talk with the chairman yesterday, and basically he put us off on some flunky, and we're not getting any response from them. So they'll pass a bill, and they'll stand up and say, "Oh, good, look, we passed a bill." And VFW will stand up there and say, "Oh, we got this bill passed." Well, here's the newsflash. We don't need the bill right now. with Procopio decision, we've got everything we wanted and more. Okay, we don't need a bill. And what they're going to do with this bill is actually narrow the scope of the Procopio decision. And we've gone up to them and said, look, if you want to use the geographic points, we think that's silly, but go ahead. But just call it something else. Call it the territorial sea. Call it a designated area. Call it a dioxin contamination area. They can call it a pork chop for all I care. You know, just don't call it waters offshore. But they're refusing to do that. They're just pressing on with it. And I think they're going to wind up really hurting a lot of sailors who could have gotten garbage.
Yeah.
Now, we do have a Senate bill, and the Senate bill is S-1195. That's by Senator Gillibrand and Senator Daines, and it has perfect language. It says exactly what we wanted to do. It defines the territorial sea and says, gee, territorial sea is the basically everything that international law says it is. It's you know, defines the maximum extent of international law. That's what we want. That's what we want the House to adopt, and they just will not do it.
Of course not. So I was on Facebook today, and before I share this, I want to make sure that it is associated with you. It's the Blue Water Navy Association members.
Right.
Is that yours?
Right.
Okay.
It's not mine. It's the Blue Water Navy Vietnam Veterans of America, but we work very closely together.
Okay, then I'll share it. I just wanted to make sure before I shared it. You know, Facebook.
Commander Wells, Ivan
Buchanan
here. I've got a question for you. Also live with us is Dan Martin. He called in. I just put him in. He's got an update for us that we'll get to here in a minute. But the question that I have for you, Commander, is this. Okay, they passed this bill. It doesn't, you know, it's missing a lot of people. Do you have anything on the books here that you're going to be doing in the future to try to, you know, get them covered?
Yes, we do. I mean, we're going to continue to push for a direct exposure theory, and we have some good evidence to support direct exposure. We've also got situations where the flights would come in from Da Nang, the daily cod, what they call the cod flight, carry on board delivery. Those planes would always be sprayed. They're covered with Agent Orange. They'd be washed down. They get all of the flight deck. It would, you know, go out into the ocean where it would be sucked back into the distillation intakes. We're going to look at the A4 Skyhawks that would fly out and do close air support. They would always go through it. And so, you know, we're never going to give up. We're going to continue to fight them on a case by case basis. But if they would let us have what Procopio gave us, then we'd have a general presumption, and we wouldn't have to be fighting this on a case-by-case basis.
Right.
Another question that I have here, too, I don't know if you know the answer. If you don't, take a guess. How many veterans out there have been affected by Agent Orange? Do you have a number?
Are you talking about the Navy veterans, or are you talking about in general?
Navy, all-inclusive, all services.
God.
Do you have the numbers?
That's hard to – I don't. I can tell you that Agent Orange, Gulf War, burn pits, we estimate a total of about 4.5 million veterans have been affected in one way or another by toxic exposure. And that includes radiation. That includes everything. Agent Orange, I'd have to say that we're probably in the nature of about 2.5 to 3 million. But the worst part about it, is it's not just the veterans, okay? It affects their spouses. It affects their children. We're seeing birth defects down to the third generation right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's been I was just going to make comment on that. We've seen a lot coming out lately on that. In fact, I think Sal Giuseppe Iozzo, who up out of Rhode Island, I believe, who ran for office up there.
Sure.
he has a family member, you know, himself, let alone his son, et cetera. You know, yeah, there's been lots of things coming out pointing to that it's going generational. So.
Let me give you an example. We had my new chief of staff's retired Air Force colonel by the name of Rob Manus. And Rob deployed with his squadron. He was a wing commander, I believe, to Guam in 2003. The year before, they had discovered very high levels of dioxin at Anderson Air Force Base. So he comes back, and about a year later, his wife has an autistic child. So in just talking to different people, he finds that a number of folks in his squadron had autistic children about the same time frame. Now, we found that there's a connection between maternal exposure to dioxin and autism. But what about paternal exposure? Nobody's done a study on it. Those are the kind of studies that we need to start getting done. So it's really hard to come up with a number because that stuff sits around forever, and we just really don't know how many people have been exposed. I mean, if you look at the use of some of the pesticides, including things like Roundup, have been used, it actually there seems to be very strict parallels with the autism epidemic in this country, okay, and really in the world. I mean, they use that herbicide all over the place. Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Panama, Korea, Guam, Samoa, Johnson Island, and in the United States, we know it's been used at Fort Drum. We know it's been used at Eglin Air Force Base, the CB base, Lejeune, Fort McClellan, and probably every base in the United States. I know there's a couple of them up in Michigan where it's been confirmed. So it's, it was a good week going. But unfortunately, it also contaminated our own people.
Well, how long is it going to take you to, you're expecting this to pass tomorrow, and if it passes, what time frame? I know any of our listeners out there that is not going to be covered should this bill pass. They're going to be wondering what, do you have any estimated time frames on when you might be able to get the rest of them covered?
Sure. Here's the thing. It's not going to pass tomorrow. Tomorrow's what they call a legislative hearing, which is more of an informational hearing. It then has to go to what they call a markup committee hearing, which is where they will actually take the vote to pass it. We're contacting members of the committee and saying, look, you need to be aware of what you're doing here. And hopefully we'll have enough to either modify it or defeat it. If not, it has to go to the full House. Assuming it passes the House, it goes to the Senate. Since we have our own bill in the Senate, we're hopeful that we can get that passed in the Senate and then go into a conference committee where we can try to get common sense to prevail. So, the battle's not over yet. We're still going to fight it. If we lose the battle,
good. I'm glad you said all that because, in my understanding, I had it in my head. That this could be, passing here tomorrow in the next, few days, and then, okay, good luck trying to get one that's all-inclusive, if you will. They're going to say, no, we already got one. Goodbye. That makes it 10 times tougher.
We still have some time. The problem you get into is the political aspect. If you get a congressman, I talked to a couple of them last night, and they're really going to look at it. But if they vote no, then what happens is it comes out all over the social media, Congressman so-and-so voted against a Blue Water Navy bill, it's always in the back of their mind. Sometimes it's easier to go along. But we'll see. If we can get enough folks convinced in the Congress that this is a bad bill, then we can defeat it. If not, we'll try to defeat it in the Senate. If that doesn't work, we'll go to the White House and see if we can get them to veto it. Sometimes these things take on a momentum, and we very well may lose it. If we do, then we have to fight this thing we'll have to fight every case on a case-by-case basis. And what ticks me off is basically have told people, look, we've got a pathway, and we're not only going to cover the 80,000, they can't take that away from us, but we've got a pathway for another 25 or 30,000, and now we're going to have to say, oops, Congress just slammed the door on us. So, but don't worry, we'll fight it off on a case-by-case basis. Case-by-case basis, there's just not enough of us to make sure that that number of people are covered. Ivan, it's just criminal.
Dan, you're live. Any comments?
Oh, my goodness. you know, as a fellow vet and Navy vet, and my sea daddy and anybody that was in the Navy would understand what that term means. He was brown water Navy, so I get what you're saying about all that nonsense. And I think you're truly doing God's work on that. I mean, wow. I mean, that you guys won this battle and you still have to fight the war on this. It's just crazy. Wow. I've heard all the stories about Vietnam. Obviously, I've never been there, but it's just crazy that, you know, what did Colin Powell, General Powell say? You know what the right thing to do? No, it was Schwarzkopf. He said, you know what the right thing to do is? Question is whether to do it.
All right. Well, Dan and Ivan, I'm going to tell you something, and I never thought these words would pass my lips. We've worked with Secretary Wilkie since Procopio came out. He's really committed to doing everything he can, okay, to get at least the 80,000 people in the Territorial Sea covered. Right now, I feel more comfortable with the VA than I do with Congress. Never thought I'd ever say that.
Yeah, that's an astounding statement.
That's very astounding.
Yeah, that doesn't mean.
Yeah, because this isn't the first time you've been on our show here. That's quite a statement coming from you, Commander.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm gonna have a drink.
I think we should all get a drink on that one. But it doesn't mean we're not fighting. I mean, fighting the VA. We did file suit against them on their final rule for the appellate reform, and you know we're gonna work to try to undo some of the damage that's doing.
You want in federal court a thing that nobody ever wins at. Guys like us don't win at that. So props to you. Bravo Zulu.
Yeah. Commander, please take the time right now and get out your contact information. It costs money to do these things. And Commander Wells is set up, you know, to do this. He's put a lot of his own money out there. But the fight's going, he's making headway, and you know, so get that information out there, so if anybody wants to donate, they'll know how.
Well, I appreciate it.
Anyway, you won in federal court, that's prevailing seas and a back win. Man, wow. Wow.
We will collect some fees off of it, but hopefully. The DOJ is going to fight me on it, but we're going to collect it. Our website is www.militaryveteransadvocacy.org, and it's one word, and we do take Visa, MasterCard, Discover. We are a 501c3, which means it's tax-exempt. You can also follow us on Facebook. We have a Military Veterans Advocacy Facebook page, and you can make a donation through there, and we're also on Twitter at MV Advocacy, capital M, capital V, Advocacy. Lowercase, and we try to keep everybody up to date. We've got about pretty close to 12,000 followers on Facebook right now. I think it's about 400 or so on Twitter. We're looking forward to doing other things. One of the issues is we need to get some sort of toxic exposure research center. I've discussed this before so we can start tracking the health trends and find out where our veterans and also our active duty are having health problems. I mean, you know, burn pits. We just gave a speech at a burn pit conference last week and attended another one at congressional briefing today. You know, gosh, we have all these 30-somethings that are in great physical condition coming back from Iraq and Afghanistan, and they can't breathe, and it's due to burn pits. We're working that issue, both legislatively with Congressman Gus Belorakis, for example, who's been a great guy to work with. And also we have a court case pending on that. What we do at Military Veterans Advocacy is we both litigate and legislate. We'll go beat up Congress to the extent we can, and then we'll file suit in the federal court system against the service secretaries or the Secretary of the VA to continue to try to push to get more coverage. We also have an education outreach program, including continuing legal education, where we train lawyers on how to do VA law, because VA law is different than the other law you've ever tried with, I can tell you.
Sorry. My bad.
And it's – no, that's right. You're right, man. It's different. And but we are training attorneys on how to do that. We're trying to get veterans law clinics set up, working on veterans treatment courts. So there's a number of things that we are doing. Yes, money does help. And, you know, I have put a significant amount of my own money in. I'm continuing to put it in, and a number of others do, too. I will tell you also, we do not take salaries. You know, there's none of our people, and we, you know, we're expanding. None of our people take a salary. We do like our expenses paid for. You know, those park benches up here in D.C. get kind of hard and kind of cold in February. But, you know, the only thing we take is money for transportation, lodging, and meals. So, you know, anything you can do to help, we'd appreciate it. It's www.militaryveteransadvocacy.org. And, again, we do take Visa, MasterCard, Discover, and American Express.
I would imagine there's a lot of competition for those park benches.
I'm sorry, say again about the park benches?
I would imagine there's quite a bit of competition for those park benches.
Yeah, right. Well, I figure, if nothing else, maybe we can afford to buy a little mattress we can take along and put them up there for us, you know.
Well, attorneys in D.C. that are trying to find a place to sleep.
Well, see, I'm based out of Louisiana, so we just travel up here.
Oh, love Louisiana.
Since you're winning and beating people up, I've got a family member I'd like to talk to you about, too. So.
Ivan, not a problem. Anything I can't do, I've got Susie Bellinger, who's, you know, the heart and soul of this whole movement. I'll stick Susie on him. I mean, members of Congress and senators just quake in their boots when they get what we call Susie grams.
Yeah. Any final comments there, Commander? We need to wrap it up. Dan Martin here, who's with us, called in. He's going to give us a brief update on his stuff going on. I've seen a little bit of action on the Facebook there,
yeah,
Dan. But any final comments there, Commander?
If you get a chance, you know, please call your local congressman and tell him to take a look at this, at the language in this bill, H.R. 299, and that we really prefer the Senate bill, which is S. 1195. If you're up here in D.C. tomorrow, stop off at that May 1st meeting and hearing. It'll be 2 o'clock in Longworth, 1134, and we could use the support.
All right. Thanks a million, Commander. Appreciate you calling in, giving us the update. Please let us know if you have any further updates coming up here in the future.
Bravo, Zulu.
Sounds like a winner. I know Rhonda follows us on Facebook, so just whenever you want me on, let me know.
Fantastic. Thank you, Commander.
Not a problem.
I'm going to put you in the blue room here. Thank you. All right, I've got Commander Wells in the blue room there. We're not going to take a break tonight. We're just going to just steam right along here. Dan, tell us what's going on with you.
Snapshot. One is, you made it kind of weird about the thing with dogs, but thanks, Ivan, for bringing that up. I don't know if you recall that. And I've been to the Philippines a few times, and I've seen some weird stuff with dogs, so I just want to put that out there. So, anyway, what's going on with me?
You're going to get me in trouble, Dan. You're always trying to do that.
Yeah, yes, sir, I will. If there was any way to play some birds chirping, I'd do that too. what's going on with me? So I'm at this weird place where the VA is trying to make a deal and to get me to shut up, and which is fine. I'll be quite honest with you. I'm okay. I think this is my 15 minutes, and if I can get it over in 7.5, I will. But they want me to accept the discipline and nobody else get disciplined so they can save face. And that's the deal I've been given. There's some words to that, and I think Ron can help me with that as a fellow vet, and I know Rhonda can, about what we'd say to that. But, you know, they're getting me to admit to things I didn't even do. And I'm just not going to do it. And so my attorneys had threatened to quit. And I'm like, okay, well, go on down the road. We're done. And then they said, well, okay, they're walking it back and all that. So, you know, I'm going on the record here because I know that everybody at the VA listens to this on Wednesday morning. So I'm not going to take a deal where I accept blame for stuff I didn't do based on the accusations of things I did not do. It's just not going to happen. I have opportunities.
Let's back up. For our listeners, hold on. For our listeners that don't know what's going on, they give a 30-second, you know, if you can, you know, update here. I mean, they pulled you off of what you're doing. They're doing remodeling. You got asbestos flying all over.
Right.
They put you in a room
right.
to where, you know, you're right there. You're sitting in the contamination day in and day out. You've been doing that for well over a year, maybe 2 years now. You know, that's just for you listeners out there. There's just a very skinny view of what Dan Martin's been going through.
I'll snapshot it real quick. So in March 2010, March 10th, 2017, I was relieved of duty based on accusations that was an altercation. Everybody in the room said there wasn't an altercation. Then it turns out we have depots and stuff that everybody that accused me of having an altercation lied
about.
What's
your position and where?
But my attorneys actually said they're going to refer that to DOJ. Where's my position and where? So I had been in a room for, 781 days doing Jack in the SH-T word, because I know you don't like swearing. I'm going to back up from that. So I had done.
No, I mean, no. What
Jack
is your job position? Your job position.
I'm the chief engineer. I'm the chief engineer for Northern Indiana VA. So,
okay.
So I accept this. So I have an opportunity to go to another VA for a promotion. Thank you very much. Where I'm going to be away from my family, and then where leave my home, all that stuff. But they don't admit any guilt. They don't, and I have to give up the fact they exposed me to silicon and asbestos. And my attorneys are sitting there going, well, but it's in the better realm of things. You know, you're so much better off. Yeah, I'm the one who has to die in 10 years. So, yeah, anyway, I had the same attorneys as Brendan Coleman. Wow. I got a way different deal than old Brendan Coleman did. So I'll tell you that right straight up.
Well, your attorney's used to doing plea bargains, and that's basically what you're looking at in a military sense.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You know, they're dealing me out. I feel like a joker right now. I don't even have any work. I'm like that burn card when you get into a poker game. You know what I'm talking about, Ron.
Yeah.
So where are you at
now?
What decisions do you have to make? And we're talking. I don't want to get into what I read on Facebook there. That's for you to say, even though it's public, but, you know.
For Facebook, I didn't put anything on Facebook other than that wasn't published. But I will say there's a really incredibly awesome story that's fixing to come out. And if you don't mind having one of those Washington, D.C., New York fellas on your show, he's going to sit there. You're going to sit there and ask him a question. And he's going to do 5 minutes of an answer. So actually, that sounds bad because that's how I am. But he's going
to
ask you a question.
I'm talking to one from Indiana.
I'm as confused as a fart in a fan factory right now. But I want to tell you that it's going to be a lot of fun, especially because he has the Office of General Counsel, on the record admitting that they supervised, signed off, and accepted. Either they were complicit or they were negligent in signing off all these sole source contracts. But now the VA is doing this full court press. They're going to get me to accept a deal, and my attorneys, hash marks in there, are going to make me, telling me if I don't accept this, I'm not going to get this promotion out to this other VA. Well, you know what? I could start a service-disabled veteran-owned business in the next 6 months and have my dignity, and I don't want to go out somewhere else and walk on eggshells.
Yeah,
right. So what are you going to do?
Oh, that's a great question. I'm going to make a joke.
I knew you were going to say that.
Okay.
You sound like my wife. Are we married?
Maybe.
So your attorneys are still trying to pressure you into taking the deal?
Yeah, my attorneys are working harder on me making this deal than they are actually prosecuting this case. That's my view on that. And I told them today I'm looking at other attorneys. Well, that was a back the something up kind of conversation.
Right.
Well, I know Commander Wells is still on listening here. I'll throw him in the hot box. You might want to contact him.
Oh, yeah, jump on in.
Recommend somebody.
You know, I'm guessing he's a shellback, so let loose.
Yeah. Well, no, I'm just saying if you want, we'll give you the information where you can contact him and speak freely, not on the air here. You know.
Yeah.
And he might be able to point you in
that.
The right direction.
No, there's going to be a lot of stuff coming up, and especially – Ivan and the next, Rhonda and Ron in the next couple of weeks, because there's these reporters that are, they're calling Office of General Counsel going, hey, you signed off on all these contracts. Well, yeah, and they're walking it back. You guys are going to love this thing. It's going to be awesome. And so where is this full court press getting me to accept a deal unless – Well, that's weird, huh? Because my attorney is supposed to advocate for me, aren't they?
Now, I'm
not in D.C. because I'm just a hick country engineer out in Indiana, but I'm not as cosmopolitan as those folks out in D.C. They seem very sophisticated. I'm sure they know what they're doing, but they're going to ask me to take a deal that – makes about as much sense as a three-legged cat trying to scratch on a frozen leg trying to poop. I ain't doing that.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you say things are coming up. Things are going to be a little more clear here in the next few weeks. Think you'll be able to come on and talk about it?
Yeah, I'm going to make this reporter come on. I spend way more time than I should, a logical person should. So, he's got way more information about me than my wife does over the past few weeks. So, I'm going to make him come on. But you have, you all have been very patient with me. Please be patient with him.
Well, Rhonda, get with Dan and this individual he's talking about, and let's see about getting him on here in the future. And,
of course.
You know, get this story out here.
You've got my
number. Alrighty.
Yep.
867-5309, is that it?
Yeah, that's it.
Jesus, Dan. All right, thanks for calling in, Dan. I'm going to put you in the blue room.
Thank you, Dan.
Okay. He's in the blue room. Okay. Well, that's basically it. Two fights going on. Commander Wells fighting one. Dan Martin fighting one. Everyone we have on here seems fighting wars here with the VA.
Yep.
That's what our show's about. Any final comments by you, Rhonda?
Yes. There was a suicide yesterday at the Cincinnati VA.
Hmm.
Another veteran shot himself in the parking lot. That's why all of the news came out today about the VA having meetings. I don't think their meetings are fixing this.
No. They need action.
Yes.
Need action. All right.
Oh, my gosh. You was talking about Venezuela. An armored vehicle just ran over a whole bunch of the demonstrators.
Yeah, they did
the National Guard.
Oh,
I just came across my Facebook just now.
Unless it's another one. I know all hell's breaking loose down there. So.
Yeah, it is.
Brown, over to you.
Yep.
All right. I do have a quote for tonight. It's by an unknown individual. Why does a person believe you when you say there's 4 billion stars in the sky? And just has to check when you say the paint is wet.
And they say what?
And just has to check when you say the paint is wet.
Okay, gotcha. No clue. All right, I want to thank our guest coming on here, Commander John Wells, regarding his updates on the Blue Water Navy. Issues having to do with the Agent Orange benefits, and also Dan Martin coming on and giving us an update. Dan, I can see you're still on there. We'll be getting with you shortly and getting you booked along with that other gentleman here on the show here coming up probably within the next 3, 4, 5 weeks. What we're booked out that far, Rhonda?
Yes, we are.
Yeah.
I went back to work.
Okay. I wasn't going to say anything. I just giving you an opportunity there. You know. All right. Thank you all for coming. This is the Buchanan Report Radio Show. We'll see you all next week. Yeah, good night.
Y'all have a good night.
Good night.